What's going on, everybody? It's Monday, time for Swift News. Who remembers that? Who's been around for a while? If you haven't heard, I am back to full-time YouTube, indie dev, content creation, all that stuff. If you want to hear more about why, I did a video all about that. I'll link to that in the description. But the reason I'm saying that, and the reason I did that little throwback intro, is because Swift News was a monthly show, but now we're going back to weekly. And back in the day, Swift News was every Monday. But there's a new addition this time around. I'm launching the Swift News newsletter, which is, you know, obviously a written version with all the links and my thoughts on that. But I wanna make it unique and make it worth subscribing to. So I will be sharing more. I'm still kicking around some ideas, you know, maybe a podcast episode recommendation, maybe a little AI tip I picked up along the way, or, you know, what I'm working on currently with my apps and how they're doing financially. I don't know, I got a bunch of ideas I'm kicking around, but I'd love to hear from you, like what you think could be a little extra to get in the newsletter that would be unique and interesting from me. I don't know. Let me know what you think. And the last bit of housekeeping before we dive into the news. Today launches my spring sale for my iOS dev courses. You get all my courses for 30% off, and the sale ends next Monday. Check it out at seanallen.teachable.com. All right, let's get into it. First up, we have Telemetry Deck, which is an analytics SDK, sharing their iOS version market share. And Mixpanel used to be the go-to for this, and I did check, they are up to date, but I haven't really heard of Mixpanel being in the mix with app analytics. I'm sure they still are, but I just don't hear their name as often as I used to, you know, 5-6 years ago. But anyway, their numbers line up. It's basically about 93%. One little tip, Telemetry Deck, we don't need 17 decimal points. Maybe fix that UI a little bit. But anyway, when you add up iOS 18 and iOS 17, it's about 93%. Here we are, what? iOS 18 came out 5-6 months ago, and we're already at 93%. So again, this comes into play for your decision-making on when should you drop iOS 16? When should you drop iOS 15, right? iOS 15 is 1.67%. Now, of course, this depends on your app. If 1% of your user base is no big deal, yeah, get rid of iOS 15. Hell, if 5% of your user base is not worth supporting iOS 16, especially if you're working in SwiftUI, it's really nice to do the N-1, right? iOS 18 and iOS 17. Now, again, if you're YouTube or Facebook and 5% of your user base is millions of people, well, yeah, that's a big deal. So this is app specific, but good data here, letting you know where we are in the iOS 18 adoption. The nice thing about Telemetry Deck, though, is they also have down here minor versions. So that was the major, right? iOS 18, iOS 17. But here you go with the minor versions. And you can see 18.3, the latest and greatest, we got 57%. And then you can see the breakdown from there. So if you're interested in the minor versions, Telemetry Deck's got you covered here as well, but always good info to know. Moving on, we have an Ode to Swift Enums by Jordan Morgan. And as I was reading this article, I just kept nodding my head. Yep, because I love me a good enum. But this post basically sings the praises of enums and shows how flexible they can be. So if you've only used enums in, you know, the basic format, or maybe you're just learning enums, or hell, even if you're a senior and you want to learn a tip or two, definitely check out this article on enums. But he just walks through the basics and then also some of the cool things you can do, right? So there's a basic enum of a practice type, how you can get a title, right? And I'll scroll down a little bit, conforming to custom string convertible. So you can just do, you know, team practice.description, and then you'll get this nice human readable string for your UI anytime you need to show it. And then you can also give these enums an ID, which makes it really easy, right? Identity crisis, that's what he's talking about. This makes it really easy to use enums in, you know, pickers or a for each, right? You just give it this var ID self equals self. Super simple to conform to identifiable in an enum, which again, then you can use it in the pickers, all that stuff. And as he's showing off, right, you can use this picker, but you have all this spelled out text. Well, another good thing about enums is case iterable. So you can basically convert all your enum cases into an array that you can iterate over, and that unlocks a whole lot of flexibility. And then there's associated types. There's just a whole bunch of awesome things you can do with an enum. So if your enum game is lacking, check out this article. I'm sure you're gonna pick up a tip or two. Next, we got RudRank out there fighting the good fight, doing all the latest and greatest cutting edge AI stuff so we don't have to. Because if you're like me, and my tweet's actually even like featured here, right? So RudRank said, in just 1 week, people went from canceling their ChatGPT subscription to subscribing to Grok to now resubscribing to Claude. And I was like, hey, that dance is too much for me, but I'm glad you're out there doing it. And RudRank launched this AIOS Dispatch newsletter to do exactly that. He's out there learning all this stuff, trying it, you know, Alex Sidebar, Cursor, Windsurf, all these IDEs, you know, GitHub Copilot for Xcode. It's mind-boggling. It's dizzying. It's way too much to keep up with. And I know, like, I feel behind, even though that is very irrational, like it's moving way too fast. I still feel behind. So this newsletter is super helpful to at least have somewhat of an idea as to what's going on. Because the way I'm approaching it, I'm going to be a fast follower. Once it all gets sorted out and one's the best or there's a best practice that emerges, then I'm going to dive on it. But while all that's getting figured out, I'm just going to sit back, read my AIOS dispatch so I'm kind of in the know, and continue on with my work. But I highly recommend subscribing to AIOS Dispatch to at least kind of stay up to date. It's not sponsored, not affiliated. I just think, like I said, I'm so glad he's out there doing all this so we don't have to. Moving on, we have key considerations before using Swift data from Fat Bob Man, one of my favorite blogs out there. They're always super in depth. And this is another long one. And basically it goes over the pros and cons of Swift data, right? He's not saying Swift data is bad, not saying Swift data is good. The whole point of this article is like, well, he says it down there later, is like Swift data is good for most applications, right? It's not like Swift data is blanket bad. But if you decide to use Swift data, you should know its limitations and know its pros and cons and then make an informed decision on whether that's good for you. And that's exactly what this entire article does. I'll talk about some highlights. How does Swift data differ from frameworks like GRDB, SQLite? And he says, basically, it's a philosophy, right? Swift data embraces the philosophy, data is an object, whereas SQLite and all that is data is a database. So if you're familiar like with database stuff and SQL and like tables, columns, rows, you know, maybe Swift data is not for you. But if you're familiar with object-oriented programming and you kind of like to think of your data models as like the objects, maybe that's more for you. But that's just a general concept because, you know, Swift data entities are not the same as regular Swift objects. And this is dangerous because, you know, he says, many introductory tutorials emphasize its convenience, which leads some beginners to mistakenly assume that building data models is as straightforward as just Swift objects. And that is absolutely not the case. He does highlight, and this is one of the main reasons I adopted Swift data, is just the ease of getting the iCloud-based backup and data synchronization. It's really easy. You get that with Core Data too, but really the reason I adopted Swift data is I believe that's where Apple's going in the future. Like Core Data is super old. It's still great, nothing wrong with it, but it's clear that, you know, Swift data is going to be the future. Like I envision every WWDC for the next few years to have a what's new in Swift data video. So it will get there. And again, my philosophy was like, I want to adopt it now. I'll deal with the headaches and paper cuts because my apps aren't anything complex. Like I said, Swift data is going to be fine for most app scenarios and mine falls into that. And I was like, well, I don't want to do a giant conversion 2-3 years from now. So I'll just adopt it now, grow with it, and I'll already be there. That was my mentality. That's not going to work for everyone. But anyway, back to the article, whole bunch of, again, just the pros and cons of Swift data, what you should consider, where its limitations are, what features it has, what it doesn't have versus Core data. So again, if you're sitting here right now wondering, hey, should I adopt Swift data for my next project or should we convert to Swift data? This is a must read article just to know the pros and cons because there is no concrete yes or no right answer for everyone. Next up, we have why you should keep your Git commits small and meaningful from Donnie Walls. And this is something I learned relatively late in my career. You know, I'm a little ashamed to say, because my commits, you know, they wouldn't be ridiculous, like a horrible pull request trying to review. Like it wouldn't be like super bad, but I definitely had larger commits than I should have because I have now adopted this smaller, concise, contained commits, you know, as much as you can, right? You can't always be perfect. And I'm converted for the past couple of years. But why commit hygiene matters? It's basically right, your commits are a snapshot of your code. So if you go back out to debug something or find out when a bug was introduced, he shows like the pain of messy commits. If you just see, you know, WIP, work in progress, or fixing things, more updates, like that's not very helpful. So commits should be small, contained, and the descriptions should tell you what's going on. Because when you're inevitably going back through your commit history 2-3 months later, like you're not gonna remember what was happening in this moment. So how small should the commits be? And I'm glad Donnie shared like a kind of specific example to really, you know, solidify the idea in your head. If you're new to making commits or, you know, relatively early in your career, or maybe you haven't worked on a team where, you know, this was as important. It's still important even if you're working by yourself, but it's, you know, 10 times more important when you're working on a team. So his, you know, rough criteria, the project should still build even if the feature is incomplete. The commit should have a clear purpose, right? Refactor the JSON to use decodable. If you're adding a function, consider adding its corresponding test in the same commit. And then he walks through this example here, right? Commit one, you add a new function up to the networking client. Commit two, add the test scaffolding. Commit three, write the actual test. Commit four, implement the feature. Commit five, rename a model, refactor unrelated code instead of bundling this into commit four. I know back in the day, this would have all been one commit for me, right? But again, the past couple of years, I have adopted this. And I want to point out, I've also adopted semantic commit messages where you kind of give, you know, what your commit is before. Now, this is a standard some teams use. You can make it your own, right? So is it a feature? Is it a fix? Is it documentation? Is it style? Now, this refers to code style, but I would argue in our world, like we need to know like, hey, was this like a UI fix? Or was this, you know, building a button, just the UI? So maybe there's a UI tag, but you just start this with your commit, right? Feet, colon, and then your commit message. chore, right? Updating the build number before you upload a test flight kind of thing. Chore, if it's a test. So I've adopted this. I like this because, again, when you're scrolling through your commit history 3 or 4 months from now, this really helps, you know, figure out what's going on. And when you're writing your release notes, this is nice too. And you can see bug fixes or features. So anyway, this is super helpful. I've adopted that as well. But yeah, keep your commits clean, small, concise. Remember, they're free. GitHub doesn't charge you per commit. So yeah, make your commits smaller and more meaningful. All right, on to the software engineer spectrum. Not that spectrum, the speed versus accuracy spectrum. And we got my guy, Jared here from Silicon Valley. If you haven't seen that show, it is absolutely hilarious and insanely accurate for being like a parody. But anyway, so what this article is all about is knowing where you are as an engineer on the speed versus accuracy spectrum. And this is the classic, right? If you would like to work at a small startup, you like to be building the MVP, you like to wear many hats, you don't like all the bureaucracy of a big company and the red tape and having a meeting, for the feature to get approval, all that drives you insane? Well, now you're on the more speed end of the spectrum. And the reason this is important is because not all, and I'm kind of like summarizing the article rather than scrolling through it, but you know, not all engineering roles are the same. So if you're one of those people that likes the speed, you don't like the bureaucracy, and then you try to go to a big company, you're just not gonna like fit in, you're gonna be out of sync, you're probably not gonna enjoy the job, and vice versa. If you love optimizing, building scalable code, making sure it's highly tested, just, you know, really going down the accuracy end of the spectrum, well, working at a move fast and break things startup is probably gonna drive you nuts, and you might not be setting yourself up for success. So again, the point of this article, highly recommend reading this. Again, not all engineering roles are the same. Know where you lie on that spectrum and maybe try to apply to those companies to set yourself up for the most success. And lastly, I got a fun one for you. If you're building a library or a framework, there's a iOS or macOS app that will create these nice little Apple-like SDK icons. I don't know, I just thought it was pretty cool. So here's the macOS app. Just basically give it your icon, pick the colors, and it'll generate one of these for you. I'm sure you're familiar, right? You see like the Swift Charts one here, or the HealthKit one here. Well, now you can kind of create your own for whatever SDK you're building and fit right in the Apple ecosystem. All right, that does it for this episode of Swift News. Again, I'm back to indie, full-time content creation. If you want to hear more about it, here's the video for that. See you next week.